above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began, above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth. There's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified and laid behind the stone, you live to die, rejected and alone. Like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall, then you thought of me above. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to First Baptist Church of Wennington. So glad you're able to worship with us this morning on this wonderful Lord's Day that God has blessed us with. I have a few announcements to get things started this morning. Just want to remind everybody about all of the various ways that you can give your tithes and offerings. We can do that through the Abundant Giving app. We can do that by the website in the upper left corner of the website, or you can continue to mail in your tithes and offerings, or feel free to drop them by the church office Monday through Thursday between the hours of 8:30 a.m. and 3 p.m. Also, remember that Sunday School is up and running virtually. David Campbell and Larry Bieber Sunday School classes are meeting at 9 a.m. every Sunday morning. And everyone, they want to let everybody know that everyone and anyone is welcome to participate in their classes. So if you're interested in that, please contact David or Larry, and they will be glad to set you up with everything that you need to participate in that. Also, the youth are meeting every Sunday morning for Sunday School virtually at 9:30. So if you are not participating in that, the email does go out as well as text messages with all the information, just as a reminder. So if you're not receiving that for some reason and would like to partake in that, please feel free to contact me as well. Also, Monday mornings, I send out a children's email. It just has a little, little lesson, Bible lesson for them, as well as some prayer points for them throughout the week and a little activity for them to work on throughout the week there. So if you're not receiving those and you'd like to, please contact me and I'll be glad to make sure that you receive those as well. I can also send you the ones that we have done since the beginning of this quarantine period. Also, Mary Beavers and Miss Betty Carnes Sunday School class is meeting at 7 p.m. on Tuesday nights virtually. So if your children are in their Sunday School class and are not participating in that, please reach out to them. They would be glad to get you the Zoom login information for that. As always, we do have our Monday morning Bible study with Marty Sanders for the men. He is continuing going through the book of Genesis, I believe. So they meet Monday mornings at 6:30, and I'm leading another Bible study for the men on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m., and we are going through the Minor Prophets and are currently in the book of Hosea. Also, the youth group, we are meeting on Thursday nights at 7 o'clock, so we'd love to have you participate in that as well. And continue to pray for the Pastor Search Committee for all the work that they are putting in and discerning the will of God and finding the man that God has for us as our next pastor here at First Baptist Church of Weddington. There's also a deacons meeting tomorrow night at 7 p.m. at the church. Deacons have been notified of that, but just in case you have not, now you know. And we will be meeting at the church house tomorrow night at 7 p.m. We've been going through the book of John, but we are wrapping up chapter 3, and we're going to take a week off next week. That's the 9th, April 9th, and we're going to have a special message on missions. We're really going to start focusing on missions. So we're going to take next Sunday, have a special message about missions, and we're going to follow that up by next Sunday evening, August the 9th, and this will be at 6 p.m. We're going to have a special virtual Sunday evening meeting, Zoom, much like we did with the Good Friday service that we had back in April, where we will be talking about the missions that we support here at the church and the status of those, and as well as issuing a challenge to ourselves. So next Sunday is going to have a mission focus. So do be praying for that, as missions are the heartbeat of the church. You know, the reason we are here is for missions, local missions, missions around our nation, around North America and around the world, as we support particularly Honduras and other foreign missions through the Lottie Moon Christmas offering of the Southern Baptist Convention. So do be in prayer for that, and I look forward to seeing you all through the Zoom meeting we will be having next Sunday night. That's August the 9th at 6 p.m. Also, have some sad news to pass along. Terry Glacius' brother-in-law, John, as many of you know, he has been suffering from health issues for quite a while now. Had a mini stroke a few weeks back. Well, he passed away early on Saturday morning. So do be in special prayer for Terry's family during this time, and particularly for Terry's sister, Carol, during this time. So let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we love you so much, Lord. God, we just thank you for the gift of life that you have given us, Lord. But we as your children, we don't just thank you for the gift of life, Lord. We thank you for the gift of eternal life, Lord, that you have bestowed upon us, Lord. Lord, we are forever grateful, Lord, and we thank you that we have eternal life from the moment we believe, Father. And Lord, we just look forward to that time of when it's all said and done, Lord, when the judgments have passed, Father, and when we are resurrected, Lord, in the eternal state and able to worship you in person, right there, face to face, Lord, beholding you, beholding our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, with our own eyes, Father. Lord, we look forward to that day, Father. And Lord, this morning, we worship you, Father, for all that you have done for us, for the salvation you have given us, Lord. And Father God, we thank you for First Baptist Church of Weddington, Lord. Thank you so much for the brothers and sisters here, Lord, as we love each other so dearly, Lord. And Father, we just ask that you will continue to guide us, Lord, to the day when we can get back together and meet face to face again, Lord, as we yearn for that, Father. Lord God, we do pray for the cause for us being absent from each other right now, Lord. We pray for the COVID-19 situation. Lord, we just ask that you will help for everything to, the curve to flatten, as they say, Lord, and for cases to minimize and eventually just vanish, Father. We pray for those who are working on a vaccine, Father, for this. Lord, we just pray that you will give them wisdom, Lord. And Father, I pray you will also give us wisdom, Father, that we the people, wisdom, as we navigate our lives, Lord, as lives are made to be lived, Father. And we need to do so carefully, Lord, and do so mindfully and cautiously, Lord. But Father, be with us as we do that, Lord. And particularly, I think about school starting back up here in a few weeks, Father. I know it starts at the end of this week for the teachers. But Father, we just ask that you will be with all of us as we are navigating these new waters that we are in, Father. And Lord, Father, we thank you for giving us the opportunity to serve you through working in missions, Lord, and having a hand in missions, Father. And Lord, always remind us, Father, of the importance of missions. Remind us of the importance of serving you, that we are here to serve you, Father. We are here to carry the gospel of Jesus Christ to everyone, Lord. Those that live across the street, those that are in our state, Lord, those that are in our nation, those that are around the world, Lord. We have a responsibility, Lord. We have a commission from you to do these things, Lord. And if we are unable to participate in them personally, Lord, then we need to support those who can financially, support those who can with our prayers, Lord, with our continued and dedicated prayers for them, Lord. Father, we pray for the missions that we are a part of through First Baptist Church of Weddington. Father, we lift all of those up to you today, Lord. Father, we just pray that you will bless them in mighty ways, Lord, and that you will use us to be a part of that, Lord. Father God, we thank you again for that wonderful opportunity that we have, Father. And Lord, we do continue to pray for our pastor search team, Lord, as they're working so hard, Lord. They have so many resumes to go through and decisions to make, Lord. Father, on top of everything else that they're dealing with in their personal lives, Lord, with work and family and you name it, Father. So, Lord, we just lift all of them up to you this morning, Lord. We just pray you'll give them an extra measure of your grace, an extra measure of rest, Father, an extra measure of focus as they continue to work so hard to find the man of God that you have for us to be our next pastor here at First Baptist Church of Weddington. Lord, we also pray for the deacons meeting that's coming up tomorrow evening, Father. We just pray that you will guard, guide, and direct us during that, Lord. Father, that we will be in one accord, Father, and that we will continue to follow the leading of your Holy Spirit, Lord. And Father, we do lift up our brother Terry and his family to you, Lord, at the loss of his brother-in-law, John. Father, we particularly pray for John's wife, Carol. Lord, just give them comfort at this time, Lord. Father, may we be a help to them in any way that we can, Lord, to Terry and his family during this time. And Father God, we do pray for our worship service this morning. Lord, I just pray you will help us all to put aside any distractions, Father, just to lay aside the burdens that we feel in life, the weight that we feel with our everyday life at times, Lord, just to lay everything aside, Father, and just focus upon you this morning, Father. Lord, and may our worship be true. May we worship you in spirit and in truth this morning, and may everything that we do this morning be pleasing to you, Father, because you are so worthy. And Father, all of these things we ask in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And I would like to add about the meeting next Sunday night, August 9th at 6 p.m. As I said, that will be through Zoom. So if you are unable to access Zoom for some reason, or you happen to maybe forget and you miss it and you would like to have been a part of that, please contact Kim at the church office, and we have DVDs. We will be glad to record that, because I will be recording that Zoom meeting for this very purpose. So if anyone missed it or anyone just cannot participate in a Zoom for whatever reason, we will record it and be sure to send that out to you, just as we do with these sermons on Sunday morning for those who are unable to participate with us here. So this morning we're going to be continuing our journey through the Gospel of John. We are going to be wrapping up John chapter 3, as I said earlier, and we're going to particularly be looking at John chapter 3, verses 22 through 36. And today's passage sees John the Baptist on the scene again. John the Baptist will teach us a very important lesson about how we are to view ourselves in light of the work of the Lord. And in a day and time where the popularity of mega churches is growing, and pastors and other people in various forms of ministry are being lauded by social media, growing in popularity and fame, it's easy for any of us to desire the spotlight in the work we do for the Lord. And we've seen that happen for many pastors, many people in the ministry that have fallen because they have fallen in love with the spotlight. So, as I said, it's very easy for us to desire that spotlight, though, but it doesn't even necessarily have to be vocational work for the Lord, but any work we do for the Lord, either at work or at the church, we need to be mindful of this. So we must always remember that the only reason we are in the positions that we are, and the only reason we have the skills, the gifts, and the abilities we have, is because the Lord has blessed us with them. And thus Christ is above all and is preeminent over all things in our lives, and not just in our lives, but in all of creation. He is preeminent in all. So please turn with me in your Bibles if you have not already. As I said, we're going to be in John chapter 3, verses 22 through 36. John chapter 3, verses 22 through 36. And please follow along with me in your Bibles as we read those passages this morning. After this, Jesus and his disciples went into the Judean countryside, and he remained there with them and was baptizing. John also was baptizing at Aenon near Salim, because the water was plentiful there, and people were coming and being baptized, for John had not yet been put in prison. Now a discussion arose between some of John's disciples and a Jew over purification. And they came to John and said to him, "Rabbi, he who was with you across the Jordan, to whom you bore witness, look, he is baptizing, and all are going to him." John answered, "A person cannot receive even one thing unless it is given him from heaven. You yourselves bear witness that I said, 'I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him.' The one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease. He who comes from above is above all. He who is of the earth belongs to the earth and speaks in an earthly way. He who comes from heaven is above all. He bears witness to what he has seen and heard, yet no one receives his testimony. Whoever receives his testimony sets his seal to this, that God is true. For he whom God has sent utters the words of God, for he gives the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hands. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Let us pray. Father, once again, we thank you for the precious gift of your word, Father. Lord, we just ask this morning that you will pierce us deeply with your word through the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord. Father, that you will challenge our hearts, Father, with the truth of your word. And Father, that we will stand upon your word in our life. Father, that we will let go of anything that is false, anything that does not hold true when held against your word. Father, make us more like your son, Jesus. And Father, I just ask for myself this morning that you will be with me. Help me to handle your word rightly and explain your word clearly. And all this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So we'll begin by looking at, verses 22 through 26. And as we can see from this passage, John the Baptist and Jesus' ministries really overlapped for a short period of time. But while they did overlap, they were not trending in the same direction. While Jesus' following and his ministry was growing and growing, John the Baptist's ministry and influence was shrinking. Much smaller crowds were now following John than were following Jesus. And John's followers were becoming very envious of the larger crowds that were following Jesus around and the work that Jesus was doing. And we know that John had become very popular due to his preaching. As Matthew 3:5 says, "Then Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region about the Jordan were going out to him." So his ministry had grown, but he had served the purpose that God had for him. And this changeover from John the Baptist and the Old Covenant to Jesus Christ and his implementation of the New Covenant was to be expected. And it was actually according to God's plan. As Hebrews 8:13 states, "In speaking of a new covenant, he makes the first one obsolete. And what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away." So I just want to take a moment and help us to understand that what was happening here was natural. What was happening here was what was supposed to happen. Of this passage, Dr. John MacArthur, pastor of Grace Community Church in Los Angeles, California, notes a few ways in which the new covenant through Christ was superior to the old covenant, was superior. So therefore, it's this natural progression that John the Baptist started out proclaiming and making the way for the Messiah. But once the Messiah came, John in the old covenant would slowly fade away, and Jesus Christ would magnify himself. He would grow in what he was doing for the Lord and initiating in the new covenant. So the first thing John MacArthur notes here is that there is a better mediator with the second covenant. Hebrews 8:16 says, "But as it is, John has obtained a ministry that is as much more excellent than the old as the covenant he mediates is better, since it enacted on better promises." And this leads us to the second way in which the new covenant was superior to the old covenant. And that is, it offers a better hope based on promises, and most of all, the promise of complete forgiveness of sin, the once and for all complete forgiveness of sins. Once again, we go back to the book of Hebrews, as Hebrews 10:4 says, "For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin." And Jeremiah 31:34, "And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more." A third way that the new covenant is superior to the old covenant is that believers have direct access to God without earthly priest. They have direct access to God without earthly priest. As we know, Jesus is our great high priest through which we go to the Father. Fourth, its blessings, that is the blessings of the new covenant, will never be forfeited by disobedience. They will never be forfeited. You will not, you cannot lose them through that. Now, I want to make a note on that, that even though you cannot lose these blessings through disobedience, meaning that we may stumble at times, we may fall into periods of sin in our lives, that does not mean that you have a license to sin, because obedience is the fruit of saving faith. So if you don't have saving faith, if you have saving faith or faith, but you don't have obedience, you do not have saving faith. And we will touch on that here at the end. We're going to loop back around to that point. Next, and fifth, it is internal, that is not on tablets of stone, but rather the new covenant is about hearts. It brings spiritual life, not spiritual death. 2 Corinthians 3:6 says, "Who has made us sufficient to be ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life." It results in righteousness, not condemnation, is what Paul is saying there. He continues in 2 Corinthians 3:9. He says, "For if there was glory in the ministry of condemnation, the ministry of righteousness must be far exceeded it in glory." The glory of the new covenant far exceeds the glory of the former. So the transition that began when Jesus Christ came on the scene was a good one. And John the Baptist knew this. John knew that it was a good thing. And while John and his disciples were in Anon, a discussion broke out about purification between a Jew and some of the followers of John. And now, as we have previously read in John chapter 2, verse 6, purification was an important matter. It was an important matter. 2:6 was the purification barrels, if you will, or jars at the wedding that Jesus was attending there. Now, scholars have learned through the Dead Sea Scrolls at Qumran that a subject of great interest among the various religious sects of that period, the period that John is writing of here in his gospel, various sects of that period, one of the biggest topics of interest was ceremonial washing and purification. We know that from a lot of the writings that we have from the Dead Sea Scrolls. So it's no wonder that this discussion was taking place here at this time, because it was a very hot-button topic at the time. So during this time, the diminishing number of John's followers was getting to his disciples. It was bothering those who were following John. So they said, "You know, Rabbi, teacher, he who was with you across the Jordan, to whom you bore witness, look, he is baptizing, and all are going to him." But John responded to this with perfect godly humility. Let's look at verses 27 through 30. John answered, "A person cannot receive even one thing unless it is given him from heaven. You yourselves bear witness that I said, 'I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him.' The one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, the joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, and I must decrease." What wonderful words from John the Baptist there in this situation. You see, it's God's providence is what determines a successful ministry. God's providence is what determines a successful ministry. It's not about the number of, I've heard someone say it's not about the fannies in the pews or the money in the plates. It's not about those things. That is not the success of a ministry or of a church. And there is no place for envy or jealousy. None whatsoever when it comes to the ministries that are going on. Every talent, every ability that we have, every talent or ability that we possess has been given by God the Father to us. It is nothing that we've done of our own that we could take credit for these things. God is sovereign over all things, and that includes the results of ministry. There could be a pastor of a small church that, you know, doesn't see many souls saved in the ministry that goes on there, but is being a faithful man of God in the ministry that God has appointed for him. And then there could also be someone who is faithful in ministry at a mega church or a large church. And he, as I said, he's faithful, and they see a lot of people come to the Lord through that. God is in control of both of those results, and God will bless both of those men on the day of their judgment. He will bless both of those men equally because they themselves were faithful to him in what he had given them. So that is what John is saying, and he knows that Jesus' ministry is growing because it's supposed to be. He knows that the reason his ministry is growing is because of the works of God. Dr. William F. Cook says the verb translated to give here, you'll see it in these passages, the verb translated to give is used 76 times in the Gospels. 76 times, especially in regard to the things the Father gives the Son. And John had already stated to his disciples that he himself was not the Messiah. We've already been over that. He then goes on to describe his relationship with Jesus in this most beautiful way here that John uses. He describes it as a relationship between the bridegroom and the bridegroom's friend, or what we would consider to be the best man at a wedding. And John, being the best man, is overjoyed at being able to serve the bridegroom. That is, John is overjoyed to be able to serve Jesus. That's his joy to do so. And you see, it is a joy. It is a privilege to be able, to serve the Lord. And we lost that joy. We lose that joy when we focus on the accolades and the praise of man that we may receive. We lose sight of that joy. Like John the Baptist, we are here to serve Jesus. That is our purpose as well. John was overjoyed because he was fulfilling the role that the Lord had for him. Here in verse 30, we have the final words of John the Baptist in the gospel, the final words. And these words tell us of his heart. These words tell us that John understood what was going on. He said, "He must increase, but I must decrease." And it's not a wonder that in Matthew 11:11, that Jesus said of John the Baptist, "Truly I say to you, among those born of women, there has arisen no one greater than John the Baptist." How true is that statement by Jesus about John the Baptist? These words of John the Baptist should truly be a prayer of every believer, that we should decrease and he should increase in our lives. People should see Jesus. We should handle situations in our lives the way Jesus would. Not the way David would, but the way Jesus would. We should seek to please him in those ways. And our service of the Lord, like John's, is not about us or even about those that we serve. It's truly not about those two things. But rather, it is about the one whom we ultimately are serving by doing what we do, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. And once again, John understood that it was God who gave him this ministry. And it was God who gave the fruit of this ministry. So when God chose to wind it up in his time, to end his ministry, John graciously accepted this. He graciously accepted this. And as we mentioned last week, when we see the word must, it is used in a manner that is a divine necessity. And here we see it used twice by John the Baptist in the same sentence when he says, he must increase, a divine mandate. It must happen. And I must decrease, also a divine mandate that must happen. Let's look at verses 31 through 36. He who comes from above is above all. He who is of the earth belongs to the earth and speaks in an earthly way. He who comes from heaven is above all. He bears witness to what he has seen and heard, yet no one receives his testimony. Whoever receives his testimony sets his seal to this, that God is true. For he whom God has sent utters the words of God, for he gives the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. So here we have John the Apostle continuing the theme that he began back in chapter 1, and that being that Christ is above all. Christ is preeminent above all. And there are three reasons John tells us this. Three reasons that John says that Christ is above all. The first one is Christ's origin. Christ's origin. He comes from above. He comes from heaven and thus is above all. Above all things. Above all people. Second, it's because of Christ's heavenly testimony. Verses 32 and 34 tell us this. As they say, he bears witness to what he has seen and heard. And verse 34, for he whom God has sent utters the words of God. He was from heaven. That is his heavenly origin. Therefore, he is above all. The words that he speaks are heavenly testimony because he has seen it. He has been there. Jesus is qualified to tell us about God the Father and to speak on his behalf in a way no one else ever could or ever has, as he has seen and heard God himself. He has seen and heard God himself. And lastly, the third reason that he is above all is that he has heavenly authority. He has heavenly authority. God loves the Son and has given him authority over all things. Hebrews 1, 2 through 3 says, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. And Paul says in Colossians 1, 16 through 18, for by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, and in that in everything he might be preeminent. Amen. Praise the Lord. And here we come to the last verse, verse 36, where John, just as last week we pointed out the six contrasts in the text last week, John uses contrast here in verse 36. Verse 36 says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. But we need to note that there is a difference between, he's not contrasting those who believe between those who do not believe. He's not doing that directly. He's not contrasting belief and unbelief, but rather he is contrasting, if you look at the text here, he is contrasting those who believe between those who do not obey. Those who believe are held up against those who do not obey. I mentioned him earlier, but Dr. William F. Cook says, the opposite of belief here is not unbelief, but disobedience. The opposite of belief here is not unbelief, but disobedience. That is what John says here in verse 36. Just as we see condemnation in this present state, as we read last week in John 3, verses 17 and 18 about condemnation, people already being condemned, already being under God's wrath, already being under God's condemnation, and we get that repeated here by John. Just as that we see that condemnation in the present state for those who live lives of disobedience, so too is eternal life. It is in this present state for we who believe and obey. Eternal life has begun, so therefore we have reason to be joyful. Saving faith must be and will be shown by a life of obedience. I cannot say this enough. Saving faith will produce the fruit of obedience. Always. There is no exception. If someone is living a life of disobedience, they do not possess saving faith, because saving faith always yields obedience. But let's look at the opposite of this. One's confession of Christ, as I just said, that is not followed by a life of obedience, doesn't possess that saving faith. It doesn't possess that saving faith. If you do not have a desire for God and to obey God, you have a serious problem. You have a serious problem. You need to seek God. You need to reach out to God. Examine your heart. See if you are living a life of obedience, because if you're living a life of obedience, that is what flows from saving faith. And John contrasts that here. I'm going to read through John 36 again. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Has it. It's here. When you believe, it's here. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains. It's already here. It remains upon them. How's your walk? How's your walk today? I had an older gentleman in the previous church I served at. He once told me, he said, the way he puts it is, how's your produce aisle? As you're walking down your faith and examining your faith, how's your produce aisle? Are the shelves barren? Is there nothing? Is there no produce? Because if you are a believer, you are walking in obedience. That's what the Word of God tells us. You see, it's not just about, you know, as we've said before, it's not just about asking Jesus into your heart, praying a prayer, walking an aisle. It's not what it's about. It's about trusting in the works of Christ and what he has done. It's about repenting of your faith and then living a life of obedience. That is what it's about. There are far too many today that are deceived. There's far too many today that on that day will hear the Lord say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. Because you see, they didn't live lives of obedience. They didn't possess saving faith. And I want you to remember that Jesus Christ is over all. John the Baptist laid that out today. Christ is above all. Christ is above all the work we do. Christ is above all the ministry work, the church work, the work we do in our personal life. He is above all of that. And because of that, we should be desiring to serve him, desiring to walk in obedience. Once again, John 3:36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Are you living a life of obedience to the Son? If you're not, trust and repent. Repent of your sin and walk in obedience to Jesus Christ. If you are a possessor of saving faith and you're living a life of obedience, praise God. But let me challenge us to live our life harder for the Lord, to go further than we've been going, to let go of more and more of ourself, to see us decrease more and more, and to see the Lord Jesus Christ increase more and more and more in our lives. The Lord is over all. He is preeminent above all things. Are you living a life of obedience that sees you diminishing, Christ increasing? Because if you humble yourself in the eyes of the Lord, He will lift you up. We don't need to worry about doing that ourselves. Humbly obey our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your words. Father, I just ask if there's anyone who, under the sound of my voice here, Lord, has not been living a life of obedience, Lord, maybe has just a false assurance and they are not truly redeemed. Father, I pray today that you will call them to yourself, Father. Lord, that they will surrender, truly let go of everything and follow you, Lord, and start living a life of obedience. As we are not saved by these works of obedience, Lord, we know that. You have made that clear in your word. We are not saved by our works. But Lord, you have made it clear in your word also that if we are saved, we will have works. We will live lives of obedience. Father, I pray you will help First Baptist Church of Weddington. Help us to be more obedient in our personal lives, Father. As I said, just to walk harder, to seek after you more and more, live more and more of a life of obedience, Lord, so that we see us decrease and you increase in our lives, Lord Jesus. Father, all this we ask in Jesus' name, amen. I hope you all have an absolutely wonderful Lord's Day today. Hope you get some extra rest in with the time that God has given us today, and be ready to get back at it tomorrow, serving the Lord Jesus Christ with everything that we do, living a life of obedience to His glory. If you need anything, be sure to reach out to your deacon, to myself, or the church office. We love you. We are here for you. Be blessed, brothers and sisters.
Never failing, and let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Mighty to save, forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Of failures, fill my life again. I give my life to follow. my God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. And come.